Hello friends, today we are going to discuss the design of an amplifier at high frequencies. Design of an amplifier at high frequency using single step matching. So I will take an example for which the S parameter is given, and using those S parameters first we will check the stability and then after that we will design the matching section. So I will take an example. The S parameter for this example is given. So as you know that any transistor can be converted into two port network. So as you can see here, this terminal is called as a collector, this one is called as an emitter, this one is called as a base for BJT, and then we'll go for the FET. The same terminals can be taken as a drain, source and gate. So these two terminal acts as an output and these two terminal acts as an input terminal. So this three port device can be converted into two port black box, where this will be the input port and this will be the output port. So this is called as a two port network. So for this two port network, the terminal characteristic will be defined by the S parameters. And there is a property, if it is a two port network, the S parameter will be 2 square. The property is, whatever will be the number of ports, the square of that number of ports will be equal to the number of elements in the S matrix. So for 2 to the power 2, it means 4 elements will be there for the 2 port network. That is S11, S21, S12 and S22. So for this example, I will take the S11 as a, already this values will be given for the particular transistor, using which that transistor you are going to design an amplifier. So here for this particular transistor, I am taking the value of S11 as 0.72 angle of minus 116 degree, and for S21 value is 2.86 angle of 76 degree. S12 is 0.03 angle of 57 degree. S22 is 0.73 and angle of minus 54 degree. So as we can see, four parameters here, they all denotes certain property. So S11 is the reflection coefficient at port 1. Here at this input port, S11 holds the reflection coefficient, S21 is the transmission coefficient, at not at, it will be from port 1 to port 2. So from 1 to 2, what is the transmission, that will be decided by the S21, and S12 is the reverse transmission coefficient. And S22 is the reflection coefficient at port 2. So by seeing the values, we can see there are certain reflections at port, input port, at the output port. So we can see the values are given as around 0.72 and 0.73. And when we'll talk about the S21, it's a transmission coefficient which determines the gain. So that value should be higher than the other values. So here we can see that value is the maximum among all four, 2.86, and the reverse transmission coefficient should be as minimum as possible. So we can see that value is 0.03. These are the general things which we should verify and identify. As if you are going to design the amplifier, the transistors S parameter we should cross verify that whether S21 is the maximum or not and the S12 is the minimum or not. Okay, after this we will check the transistor stability. So there are two parameters by which we can say that whether transistor is stable or unstable. So to claim that my transistor is unconditionally stable, there are two parameters. First is del, which is determinant. If we know the these four parameters, means element of the S matrix, I can easily determine the determinant, which is nothing but S11 into S22 minus S12 into S21. So all these four values are there, so easily we can determine the value of determinant. So here I have calculated, so you can use the calculator. Okay, so already as I told, to find out the determinant del value, we have all these four parameters. So first S11 is given in polar form, 0.72 angle minus 116 degree. So first what we'll do is how to convert this polar value into rectangular, that I'll tell you using the calculator, which is FX991MS. In this it is like on. So first you have to press shift and then we have to convert this polar value into rectangular form. So we'll press the minus button. Here you can see a rectangular bracket. So this rectangular value, now these two values we have to give separated by the comma. So first I'll enter 0.72 comma, with sign we have to enter the angle value, minus 116 bracket closed. If you press equal, we will get the real value, that is minus 0.315. then you have to press the alpha button, this one. Then you have to press the 10. You will see the symbol of F. Now if you press the equal button, you will get the imaginary value, that is minus 0.64i for the notation. So likewise we can convert any polar value into rectangular values. Okay, we are doing. So now what we have to do, S11 into S22, we have to multiply S11 and S22, and we have to multiply S21 and S12. We have to include the magnitude as well as angle for the multiplication. So S11 into S22, this. So we'll multiply 0.72 into 0.73 and angle will be added in the multiplication. So this will be, after multiplication, minus 0.517. Now this will be 0.525 angle minus 170 degree, and S12 into S21 will be equals to 0.0786 angle 133 degree. Now as we know that we have to subtract these two, so we have to convert into rectangular form. So the rectangular form of these two value will be minus 0.517 minus 0.091i, and for S12 and S21 this will be equals to minus 0.053 plus 0.057i. Okay, now so after this subtraction we will get S11, S22, minus S12, S21. That value will be minus 0.457 minus 0.147i.
So again this value we have to convert into polar form. In polar form that value will be 0.480 angle of minus 162 degree. So here we can see the determinant del value, that magnitude of the del is less than 1. So first criteria is satisfied because that value is 0.480, the magnitude. Now next is the parameter k. To claim that my transistor is unconditionally stable, the parameter k is given by 1 minus mod of S11 square minus mod of S22 square plus determinant del square divided by 2 times of S12 and S21. So already we know the values of S11 magnitude, S22 magnitude, and determinant del I found out 0.480, and S12 and S21 multiplication also we got it. So when we'll calculate this, we will get k is equal to 1.15. So this is also is the second parameter. So k should be greater than 1 to claim the transistor is unconditionally stable. So here that value 1.15 is greater than 1. So my transistor is unconditionally stable. Okay, so now next step is to find out the gamma S and gamma L. Gamma S is the source reflection coefficient and gamma L is the load reflection coefficient. These two value, once we'll find out using the Smith chart, we can design the matching section which will match the input and output both the section. So for gamma S, there is a formula derived. Gamma S is equal to B1 plus minus under root of B1 square minus 4 mod of C1 square divided by 2 times of C1, and gamma L is B2 plus minus under root B2 square minus 4 times of C2 square divided by 2 times of C2. So already the formula is given for these parameters B1, C1, B2 and C2 in terms of S parameter and determinant, because we already determined the determinant and we have the parameter S11, S22. So we can find out these B1, C1, B2, C2 values. B1 value is given by 1 plus mod of S11 square minus mod of S22 square minus determinant square. So and C1 is given by S11 minus determinant del into S22 conjugate. B2 will be given by 1 plus S22 square minus S11 square minus del square, and C2 will be given by S22 minus del S11 conjugate. So by finding out B1, C1, B2, C2 using these all parameters, then placing these values here, we can find out gamma S and gamma L. So I have calculated the value for gamma S and gamma L. Gamma S is 0.872 angle 123 degree. So using this value, we can design the input matching section. Okay, so now using this gamma S value, what already I found out, 0.872 angle 123 degree. We are using the now Smith chart. How to plot this value on Smith chart, and then we'll try to reach the center position, which is called the matched position in the Smith chart. So our value is 0.872 magnitude and angle is 123 degree. So from here we have to from the line already using the scale, we can find out the 0.872 from the reflection coefficient line. So at the center we can see it is a 0, and using this line we can see 0.8 is here and 0.9 is here. In between this, we will be getting 0.872. So from this scale, we will read out 0.872 is here. Okay, see, so using this scale, you can find out this distance, okay, which is exactly 0.872, and in the same distance, we have to find out here, and we have to draw a circle for this one. So we can use the compass box. And then we'll keep the snow at center and we'll draw a circle. So why I'm drawing this circle towards this side is because I know the angle 123 degree. Here it is 0 and this point is 90 degree. 123 degree will be around this point. So that's why I'm drawing this, and then I will draw a line which gives me the exact position. So I'll read out the value. This is 110, 120 and 130. So our 123 degree will be in between the 120 and 130, somewhere here. So from the center, using the scale, I will draw a line towards the 123 degree. So with this circle, arc of the circle, and this point gets intersects here. So this point is our gamma S, which is 0.872 angle 123 degree. Okay, we are going to use the sun stump matching. So for sun stump matching, we have to plot the exactly opposite point on the Smith chart, because this gamma S also represent the ZS value, impedance, source impedance. But when we go for the shunt stub, we have to plot the YS value, source admittance. So exactly opposite side, will extend the line and again using the compass, we'll draw the circle which gives us the intersection. This will be our YS value, admittance value, for the same source impedance without changing the VSWR, because we are moving on same circle. Now our aim is to bring this point to the center of the Smith chart. Then only we can say that our input section is matched. So again we'll draw the full circle. And we'll see the intersection of this circle with the unity circle. Unity circle means where you are seeing the point 1, you can see that there is a unity circle with real part of 1. So this gives you intersection at this point upper side, and one intersection will be getting at the lower side. So as we are moving from the our load point to the source. Now for this section, if you consider, this is our load, this is source. So we are moving towards the source point. So from here we are moving towards the source, and then we are reaching the matching point. So the line length will be given by this center, the arc of the center. What is the length of this line will give you the line length of the stub. And then we can find out the open stub length by finding the value for corresponding to this arc. Okay, so when as I told you that when we are seeing this side, we are looking towards the load, and when we are seeing this side, we are looking towards the generator. So when we'll start from this side, we are we have to move towards generator. So our center point is this, and an Smith chart, if you'll see here, it's written as a wavelength towards generator. Means if you'll rotate like this, means we are moving towards generator. So from here we started, and we are moving like this till what point my YS circle intersects. At this point we have to extend a line, so join the center and join this intersection point and extend it and mark it here. Now another concept is whether we are going for the open stub or short circuited stub. We are going for the open circuited stub. So on a Smith chart, when we'll consider it as an admittance chart, this point will act as an open circuit and this point acts as a short circuit. So we'll start from here. This is my open circuit point. So the length of the open circuited stub will be given in terms of lambda till here. So here it is 0 lambda, and here we can read it as a 0.208 lambda. So this will be the length of the open circuited stub for this. 0.208 lambda is the length of the open circuited stub. Now real part is matched here, but we have the imaginary part. So this imaginary part, when you extend, so for the imaginary part we have to bring this point to the source admittance. So to add this imaginary portion, we have to add extra length. So that length will be given by the difference of the YS point, which I will take it as a D1, and the intersection of the unity circle with the admittance circle. So this will give you the D2. So D1 minus D2 will give you the length of the line after the open circuit stub. So here we can read it as a 0.33 lambda. You have to read on outer circle. This is the wave length in terms of lambda. So this is 0.33 here when you are extending the center line from the D1 point. And the second D2 point is 0.208, same value lambda. So difference of these two will give you the length of the line, that is 0.330 lambda minus 0.208 lambda will give you the length of the line, which will be added after the open stub. So you can find this, then the solution is over for the input matching. Length, so difference of these two is nothing but 0.122 lambda. So this will be 0.122 lambda. Now lambda value, how we can find it out is, for what frequency we have designed. If our frequency, if I'll consider it as a 4 gigahertz, so corresponding to 4 gigahertz, find out the wavelength and then replace these two values, 0.20 lambda and 0.122 lambda. So we can get the lambda value from here and we can replace, and finally we can say that our solution is ready for the input matching section. Thank you.